So I got arrested quite, I got arrested in my first year.
Because of the entertainment?
Yeah,
what was the story there? Tell us about that.
We threw a party and we got raided. I'm in the big leagues, told them don't miss me. Ballin' like Houston, ayy, feeling like Whitney. I need a bag, bruh, send it through quickly. I'm making his dog, like I'm in the big leagues. Told him that I gotta go, dog. I'm riding a road, y'all. So what is your business? What do you do today? That's a hard question to answer, but I'm going to try answer it. Predominantly, our business is structuring transactions. So we're in the commodity space. ENT first started in the commodity space. But I've had different passions throughout my life.
Yeah, so tell us some of them.
Music, we have a music production company called PSR. We have a production company, visuals and television, called Scout Studios. We're also in the farming space with a company called Pick Produce, where we do like household deliveries for fresh produce.
Wow.
So it's
everything.
we try every idea.
Yeah.
Any idea that sounds sound.
Yeah.
So we look at ourselves as an investment company, but with particular focus on certain things, which is mining predominantly.
So the main thing is mining. Yeah.
Mining. Okay. Yeah, correct.
And
energy.
And when you say we, is it a business partner? Are there a few business partners?
Yeah. So it's I started the business with a mate of mine called Daniel. Daniel mm-hmm. Ayer. I've known Dan since we were 16, and we just always been in touch with each other. We went to UJ together. Dropped out together.
Wow, and so then, yeah, you've just so, been moving together, making yeah, moves together.
No, okay. He's been somebody that's, to me, been very crucial.
So it was obvious to get into business together then.
Yeah, he was actually probably my first investor
okay.
ever. He took his pocket money. In high school, we used to throw parties. So we used to host a whole bunch of events.
Yeah.
And he raised his pocket money, trusted us with it, and... yeah, we threw a party, but we lost the money, unfortunately.
It's fine. Sometimes you have to take an hour.
Exactly, yeah.
And so how long have you been in this specific commodity? You said it was mining and energy space. How long have you been working?
9 years.
9 years?
9 years now in September.
Okay.
So actually, yeah, it's our anniversary this month.
Coming up. Okay,
yes,
cool. That's sick.
Yeah.
And it's a bit of a tough question to answer. People don't always know exactly, but what would you say is your estimated net worth at the moment?
Because we are where we are, we've got a lot of capital and stuff in investments.
Yeah.
So I would today just put it at a net zero.
it's funny you laugh, but most people say that, you know, it's just,
yeah,
when you're drafting on things, you...
Exactly. You're investing at one point, you're doing a lot of things. And I think, you know, I value my net worth very differently to people. I look at it, you know, in terms of what we're working on, the potential of what we have, you know, how that's going to grow into the future. I mean, I'm 30, so
yeah.
I've got, you know, it's one thing to be caught up in how much money you have now
yeah.
or be focused on what you're trying to build. And
right.
I think for the longest time, we've just been grinding away. I've never done an evaluation on myself. I don't think it matters. I think, yeah, my
yeah.
biggest value are the people around me and the people we work with at the moment. And one day, We'll get to that figure.
Yeah, 100%. I agree with you.
Yeah.
And so how did you get things going with the mining and energy company? What were the beginning stages, you know?
So I'd been on a creative team for about a year. I was at UJ, dropped out, found myself in trouble in our first business, the entertainment business. So I got arrested I got arrested in my first year.
Because of the entertainment?
Yeah.
What was the story there? Tell us about that.
We threw a party and we got raided.
Okay.
And there were a few people I was 18. So there were a few 17-year-olds there. So because of the age of some of the people there, the party got raided.
Yeah.
And we ended up, this is just before Matric Vac. Ended up, you know, this party, they took all the money, all the profits, everything we'd made that evening.
Wait, who took it? The guys who...
The club.
Oh,
yeah.
The club. Unreal.
They took it, said, no, we had to pay bribes, whatever. I'm like, I don't pay bribes. I wasn't there. And then, so they took the rest, all the profits there. So then I owed quite a lot of people money, you know,
yeah.
and then found myself in trouble. Got arrested at UJ, funny enough, just before athletics practice. And that was actually probably the last I ever went to UJ. And that was just purely being embarrassed about what had happened, what had gone on. And also, I think that was the first point I learned, you know, there's a difference between passion and, you know, knowing when to let something go.
Yeah.
And I, at that point, I hadn't learned the ability to let things go. So I left UJ, joined and actually became a chef for a while, worked at a restaurant because that was quite a big passion of mine. And then joined a creative arts team called Youth for Christ for a year. After that, started working for a company called Dozer. And I came in as a general worker, obviously.
So around what age were you when you started working at Dozer?
I was 20.
20, okay.
20. So I stayed there for 2 years. 2 years, started off sweeping floors. From sweeping floors, became like a general worker in that store. Then became a store supervisor, managed the store. Then got called into the sales desk. And then started selling these yellow equipment because we're selling mining equipment.
Okay.
And I never understood, like, why do people spend so much money on this equipment? It made no sense to me. And I think eventually I got inquisitive, started looking into like the other side of the business. And that's when I asked a few guys who I was supplying yellow equipment to if they could give me the opportunity to try sell some of their commodities.
Is yellow equipment a term used for mining?
For mining equipment,
okay.
Correct.
I
yes,
mean,
yeah.
Obviously don't know
so. Yeah, so Caterpillar have all these big yellow.
Yeah,
yeah.
Okay,
so yeah,
gotcha.
Exactly.
Okay, so so you worked your way into a predominantly sales role.
Sales role,
yeah.
And it's pretty much the same role I play today.
Okay.
In the business.
So what's the difference now? Are you just, is it on a bigger scale that you're working in a sales role?
Yeah. So now I'm the commercial director and CEO of the business, unfortunately for my sins. I told everyone this was a good idea, so I have to carry the brunt.
But yeah.
It's one of those things. But yeah, we trade. So we set up long-term trades between international off-takers, local end users, so people that would use coal or chrome for the actual end product.
Yeah.
You know, so coal is coal in the ground, but it's electricity in our homes. It's steam to make paper, you know, and I only learned that, trust me, only after I started the business.
You're trying to make me feel better not knowing this stuff.
But it's just, so it's been a journey. And
so wait, how did you transition then from Dozer into what you're doing now?
So I asked, the guys who were supplying material, Caterpillar equipment to, I remember meeting a guy called Dale Packham. We still work with him today. He owned Eka Group. And I asked him for an opportunity to try Sully's coal. And I phoned them one day and I'm like, holy, you know, how much coal is this? You know, because we'd try to move diesel and the volumes weren't as big.
Yeah.
But what attracted me about coal was it was massive volumes. And we had tried other commodities, manganese out of Zim, chrome, and Dale really gave me an opportunity. And we had lost a bit of money trying to explore those other opportunities. And he gave us a chance. And then it rained one December. 2013, Sapping Gondwana gives me a call, and they ask if we, you know, if we had peas available to sell them. And I phoned Dale Packham and I said, yo, can I get those peas? You know, they've placed the order. And he gave us the opportunity.
Okay.
And after that, I quit.
You just did it on your own?
I gave a formal resignation at work. Daniel came in from Durban.
Yeah.
He also quit everything he was doing because he had relocated from Durban to Joburg already.
Yeah.
Working at AfriHost in the call center.
Yeah.
And we both said, look, if we're going to do this, we're going to just have to try.
Yeah,
and
go all in.
And he gave some long story about a World War I and a sergeant burnt a bridge behind him. So the only way forward was, you know, ahead of you.
Yeah.
And we said, okay, cool, let's take the leap of faith. And
yeah,
we've been here now 9 years. So we hope we're getting into our 10th year and we take it for the rest of our lives. But it's, yeah, that's
sure,
how it happened.
So what was the initial investment you needed? So you spoke about how you got that first deal, right?
Yes.
Did you still need to put in your own money to get things going once you took that leap of faith?
To this day.
To this day, okay.
Just last week, I mean, we had to Yeah, I mean, it's been COVID for the last 2 years. Things, you know, have been bumpy. And you have employees that you have to, you know, always make sure that things are okay or try and make them as okay as possible. And the business we had, because of all the riots and everything else that took place in KZN, we stood still for 2 months.
Really?
So, you know, just now, last week, we had to take out some of our own money and, you know, put back into the business. And I think it's something that you'll continue to do.
Yeah, you're always pumping into the business.
Yeah.
The initial investment, though, was that quite big?
Okay. Yeah, so no, it was actually, the first investment, Daniel gave me 2,500 Rand.
Uh-huh.
Another guy called Sungwa gave us 4,000 Rand to register the business, do all our tax stuff.
Yeah.
So that was the initial investment.
That's relatively small when you look at what some other businesses need to get started.
So. No, correct. Look, but I mean, if we talk about Dale and them, I can't remember what we sold our coal for at that time. But they trusted us with like 3,000 tons of a good quality material. So that was over 4 million Rand. But they gave that to us on terms, you know, so that's an investment. And I think ever since then, we've always had these different companies come in and invest in our business and help us grow. The number's crazy. I think raised over a billion Rand.
Yeah. I mean, of course, if you're wanting it to continue growing, which you do want to happen with your company, you need to keep pumping into it.
You need to just,
It's the standard. It's normal. Yeah.
So it's look, the investment to date now is probably close to a billion Rand that we've raised for our own business and other businesses. But yeah, the initial capital is I think it's still there.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's why it's difficult to answer. Yeah, but it was 6,000 Rand.
Yeah. And the returns you've seen so far, I'm assuming they're good. Otherwise, you wouldn't have carried on with the company.
So 2017 was a tough year for us. We lost close to 20 million Rand. We had guys.
What happened? Why was that? If you don't mind sharing.
Guys, I think when we have dreams, sometimes people chase their dreams for money.
Yeah.
So when they see cash flow come in, you know, it doesn't mean it's your money.
They get excited.
Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
And they then, you know, took a withdrawal from, we had prepaid for coal. And then on the back end of that, they took money, asked for a refund because they had taken us to the mine. And they got that refund paid back into their account. And so we lost 20 bar.
In a nutshell, it's just shady.
Shady people, shortcuts.
Yeah.
You know, and so we thought we're actually going to close down. And I think
I was going to ask, was that significant enough that you guys thought about shutting down?
Almost. No, I think up until 2020, did we see we just didn't stop trying and getting into new transactions. But in terms of living hand to mouth for a long time, that's what it was. It was, you know, surviving and pushing and trying and getting it back to where the business was. And I think, you know, we're stronger for it now.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
And I'm sure you learned some lessons from it, you know.
Painful ones.
Yeah. Expensive ones.
Painful ones.
And would you spoke in the beginning how you had many different passions, you know, in the music industry, et cetera, et cetera. Would you consider this your passion? Could you do it for the rest of your life?
I'm doing it for the rest of my life.
You're doing it for the rest of your life.
And even the music. And I think that's one thing I've decided to do is to follow my passion and work towards that. Because then it's something you wake up enjoying doing. It's just something your heart kind of connects to.
Yeah.
And, you know, you do more, you do better for it. You actually look to improve what you're doing when you're passionate about it. If you're just doing a job, you kind of just tick boxes, right?
Yeah, of course.
And you don't put, you know, extra effort.
You're just going through the motions.
Yeah, exactly.
There's no passion, there's no heart in what you're doing.
Yeah, 100%. 100%.
And so touching again on, you know, you said 2017 was a difficult year. In any business, you're going to have challenges, hurdles. Would you say that was one of your biggest challenges or hurdles, or is there?
It was the most definitive.
Yeah.
Do you get what I'm saying? I think we had just started making money as a business because we start the business 2013. Fast forward 2017, we start like, holy moly, there's a lot of money.
Yeah, we're making some cash. Yeah.
And then lose it within like 6 months.
So, surely that was quite discouraging. Did you feel like giving up? I don't know.
Yeah,
you know,
it must
be mad discouraging.
I think at that point, I'd quit drinking for a very long time. And yeah, it does something to you mentally. you know, that literally just, and you kind of have to choose, okay, am I just going to give up on this, or, you know, or are we going to try and make it out?
What gave you the motivation to push through? Was there something specific, or was it just internal? You're like, no, I'm going to just push through. Was there something
that's... didn't want to let down our partners. You know, there were people that had believed in us and seen us.
So you wanted
us
to see it through for them.
Yeah. And be able to try pay them back. And, you know, again, it's that there's a loyalty code in good business.
It's honor.
Yeah. And I think more than anything, it was that. Not wanting to be like, oh, flip, why trust that oak? You know, it was, we'll sit here and we'll take the abuse. You can shout at me, I've done something wrong, but yeah, I'll correct it. Yeah. You know, and that's the most important thing in life is we all make mistakes, but it's how you honestly correct your mistakes that pushes you forward as a human being. You know, and that was the thing for me. Yeah. And I think for Daniel as well, it was, we're not going to drop our heads the next time we see the person we worked with, you know, go greet them, tell them, look, I mean, I know that went wrong, but we're going to fix it.
Yeah.
You know, and be honorable even to that, because there'll be times where you don't want to and you're like, but why am I doing this? And then it's just like,
Yeah. So you spoke about how in 2017, before that happened, you guys started making some good cash.
Yeah.
I was like, wow. In any business there, you know, at least in your mind, if you haven't made it there yet, there's a moment where you sit back and you might feel like, oh, I've made it.
Was that
moment? Is that moment still to come? What would it look like?
At that moment, yes, I thought it was.
Okay.
At that particular moment, I was like, oh, wow, you've made it. Oh, it's never going back again. Yeah. And I mean, we were laughing the other day with my brother and we were just talking. And I was like, there's so many moments we said, never again. We'll never be that broke again. We'll never go through that again. But I think it's a journey now. And I think that taught us never to get arrogant. When it's good, it's never that good. When it's bad, it's never that bad.
Yeah.
You'll bounce back from both. Life has a way of sort of equaling you out and keeping you humble, keeping
teaching
you going.
Lessons.
Exactly.
Yeah, keeping you grounded. Yeah.
100%. So I think that moment's still to come.
Okay.
I think that moment is... When we're old, man, I think it's...
Do you know what it'll look like for you? Is it based on, you know, the size of the company? Is it based on...
Impact of the company.
The people that you work with and interact
people,
with?
People, communities. Yeah. I mean, we've tried to structure mining very differently. You know, we do a trust at the moment for the community. We do, you know, we look to do 10% for our workers. So the bottom line also matters for... everyone that works in your company, you know, so
smart. I like
that impact carries forward to people outside of yourself. You know, if you hold on to 100% shares and oh, it's my company, you know, you end up with nothing.
Yeah.
You know, but if it impacts people, it continues to grow because it sustains people, not just self-sustaining. So I think for me, successes will be governed on how many people we manage to impact, change their lives and change my own life, definitely. But I think, that comes by caring about someone else first, not just inward sort of looking metric and
like
saying,
greed and
billion rand. I used to, I'm chasing $1 billion.
In dollars?
Yes.
I love that.
You know, but whether I make it or not, I think that won't say whether I'm a success or a failure. It's how many people I've managed to impact along the way that will determine if I go to, you know, and say, okay, no, I've done my part. I mean, my mom passed away earlier this year and she always used to say to me, Emmanuel, if I leave you with nothing else but Jesus in your whole life and the ability to carry on and fight and be happy and have a good life, I've done my part. You know, if I don't have to leave you with cars or money. And my mom honestly didn't. She left me with something way more valuable than cars and money. I bought my first car. I had to, you know, I've taken taxis. But what my parents left me was far greater
than anything
monetary or physical. Monetary or, physical, like cars.
Material things.
It just, it's, and that's something that's, Unfortunately, it stuck to me. They've beat it into me.
So, yeah, that's awesome. So, what would you say are some of the visions you still have for the company? What's the name of the company, by the
way? ENT Minerals.
How did I miss that?
ENT Global Investments is the name of the overarching overall company.
Yeah, yeah.
And then we have our subsidiaries.
ENT Minerals.
Correct.
So what are some of the visions you still have for ENT Minerals to, you know, take it to the next level?
To the next level. Do you have
some?
Yeah.
I'm sure you've got some things in the pipeline.
We have wild ideas. I mean, Africa is known as the dark continent. And we hope one day to power Africa. I mean, you have 600 million people in Africa without power still today.
So there's a lot of opportunity there then.
A lot of opportunity and a lot of need.
Mm.
You know, and if we can make energy more efficient in the continent, be able to create infrastructure that allows for energy, you know, so we're looking at renewables. You know, we have a French partner that we're talking to, looking to implement renewable projects here in South Africa. We're looking to take some of our mines renewable. So we're looking to progress, you know, everything that was fought for, you know, this democracy and equality and unity that was fought for, you know, we're looking to take it forward and make us the next boom in the world. Yeah.
So you know, some big dreams.
Yeah, we love massive dreams, but we'll keep trying. We're not guaranteeing success.
Yeah, 100%. And in the 9 years that you've been working in this industry, you know, with any like venture, you're going to come across times where you might have to come across a crossroads, right? So you might have to make one choice against another.
Yeah.
Do you have any like moments where you think back and like, oof, I wonder what would have happened if I made this different decision? It might have turned out better.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Do you have any moments in the journey like that?
So the part of the story when I was telling you when we lost that money, there was, we had just got excited about having money. So we were partying, we were having a good time. But when I look back, that impacted our decision-making on an everyday basis.
The partying and the...
Yeah.
Okay.
Partying and the lifestyle.
Why did it impact the decision-making? How? Did you just become more nonchalant?
You become nonchalant. You hung over. You're
less
work.
Focused, I guess.
Yeah, you lose distract. You're very distracted on what's important. Okay. And because of that, we maybe picked the wrong partners. You know, maybe if we weren't so just overly happy to be doing deals, we wouldn't have done the deal with those guys, you know, and you start thinking about all those things. And that was the moment we had to say, okay, look, let's take time with our deals. Let's look into them. Let's really do DDs and dive into the detail, you know, not just look at, oh, I make 10 Rand, I make 20 Rand. And then, yeah, let's do it. It's more important than that. And I think that was the crossroads and took us maybe 2 years after properly, you know, no, a year, 2018, where we made that decision mentally and as a company. And we said, look, we'll never rush into transactions. We'll never let anyone rush us. We'll take our time and we don't want to let down again, our partners, you know, because people will trust you along the way. It's about delivering on what you've been trusted in.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that was our main crossroad for me right now.
Yeah.
You know, and hopefully we can stick by that and continue to just be, you know, I remember my mentor, Uncle Rolf, he used to say, excellence is in the detail.
Oof, yo, I'm going to write that one down.
Yeah.
100%. Yeah.
And it's all about the detail. And that was in the creative art space. We were doing a production called Yo Africa. And would practice, and if you made one mistake, he'd make you do it again. And he'd be like, excellence is in the detail, even in business. You know, you want to build an excellent business.
Carries across to everything.
Yeah. You want to be the best, excellence is in the detail. Not the what people see. It's in the stuff that won't be noticed.
Yeah, more like in the background stuff. Though. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Right. Yeah.
And genuinely, would you say you're happy at the moment?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think times get hard.
Of course, you're going to have moments where you're not happy.
Yeah.
In the overall bigger picture, you would say you're happy, yeah?
I think I'm content. You know, I think there'll be good times, there'll be bad times, there'll be ups and downs. But I think I'm happy with the choice I've made and, you know, what our targets are. You know, again, it's a life more fulfilling lived for others than lived for yourself. And that's what makes me happy. As I look around at our team now, I think we're like 50 across all the different businesses. And you see the joy it brings to different parts of the business, and you see it growing, and you see their businesses growing, and that's always exciting, you know. And yeah, so I'm happy.
And lastly, what is one message you would want to give to a young entrepreneur, you know, someone starting out, looking at starting a company or their own personal venture? Is there one message you'd want to give to them? You could see it as even maybe giving a message to your younger self.
Younger self.
Yeah.
Don't believe the hype. Okay. Never believe the hype. But more importantly is don't stop trying. You know, you'll make mistakes. You will bump your head. You know, but surround yourself with the right people. Iron sharpens iron. Keep going. Don't quit. You'll cry. I will probably cry later on tonight. But tomorrow morning you put on a smile and you put your best foot forward.
Keep it moving.
Because the journey is long, it's hard, it's treacherous, but we'll get there. You'll get there. I mean, it's inspirational that you've started what you started. You know, all those steps, I promise you, today may seem insignificant, you know, but in the long run, if you just keep going, just put the blinkers on, just keep going and surround yourself with the right people, you know, you'll
go far.
You'll go far.
The distance.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, it's not guaranteed. Nothing in life is guaranteed, but you'll live life knowing that, you know, I've put my effort into this. I've given it my all. And and for most of the times it pays off, mate.
I mean, you're speaking from experience.
Yeah.
I mean, you went for how many years, but when that bad deal happened, 2017.
Four years.
Four years.
Yeah.
Then you said only 2020 did you see it start coming back. So
I mean,
your advice isn't just advice; it's from experience.
Yeah. Look, and it's
so that's awesome. Yeah.
Yeah, man.
Mad respect. Yeah. Well, look, I appreciate you coming on the show. That was awesome.
Thank you for the opportunity.
But yeah, wait. Thanks, bro.
Thank you so much.
What is up, you absolute weapons? Thank you for watching and listening to None of Your Business. If you haven't already, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you want to follow us on Instagram, TikTok, Twitter, and all of those beautiful places, you can find the links in the description below. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Until next time. Like I'm in a big loop.
There we go.
Yo,
I won't
lie. In there, me almost caught a tear.
Oh, that's cool. Yo,
I always cried too.
Your story is epic.